Now, many people have also been asking, are the Pulse Asia surveys accurate? Are they reflective of the true sentiment of what we're seeing today? We have with us Pulse Asia Executive Director Anna Tabunda. Professor Tabunda, good morning to you.
Good morning, Karen.
All right, let's talk about how the survey was conducted. What is striking is the admission of Ronald Holmes, the president of Pulse Asia, that in the last two surveys, only the C, D, and E classes were included in the surveys. No middle class, no A, which is upper, and no B were included. Is that correct?
Yes.
And why is that?
Well, we were not able to sample them, or if we were able to sample some of them, they may have reduced.
So doesn't this make the survey, I mean, not completely accurate? It's not representative of, for example, the whole Philippines or even the whole NCR.
Well, not really, because the C is the more dominant class in class A, B, C.
Okay, let's talk about the numbers. When you say it's more dominant, let's talk about that. How many voters are in C, D, and E?
Well, there are about 10% of the voters in class A, B, C, including A, B, and about 70% to 75% in class D. In class D, that would be about 15 to 20%.
Mm-hmm. So what you're saying, Professor, is it doesn't matter really if you survey the A and B. It won't change anything.
Well, they won't be able to pull the figures.
Mm-mm. Okay, so it's really the C, D, and E. And has this been a new practice of Pulse Asia?
We do not intentionally exclude A, B. We are just unable to capture them.
Uh-oh. But is this declared? In other words, is this declared?
It's evident. It's evident in the titles, in the headings of the columns in the data tables, because we put in C. When there's AB, we put ABC.
Mm-mm. So you do have some people asking, how do you factor in the crowds that actually go out to the vice president's campaign?
Well, some of them would be represented in the survey, but they would be represented in approximately the same proportion that we find in the population of registered voters.
So you believe that regardless of essentially how campaigning has shifted, these are the numbers on the ground.
Yes, that's what we're getting.
Okay. Now, you also had other parts of the survey, which is quite interesting. You had a few questions. The greatest concern for the poor, most honest and trustworthy, least corrupt. Let's talk about those questions.
Unfortunately, that is an embargoed question that was leaked. And I have no access to that because it's that client is not assigned to me. So I have no access to those characteristics.
Wait, can you explain that? In other words, that's not part of the actual Pulse Asia monthly survey.
No, it's part of our survey. It's a rider question that's embargoed. And because it's embargoed, it should be available only to the client. Even I cannot see it if the client is not assigned to me, which is the case in this situation. So I haven't seen those figures.
So is it possible it's the client who leaked it?
Yes, it's possible, or someone close to the client.
Yeah, because in all these questions, who has the greatest concern for the poor? Who is the most honest and trustworthy? Who's the least corrupt? It is Mr. Marcos, who leads by a mile.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And I'm curious, Professor, how does it work in Pulse Asia? Because clearly these numbers, you know, it shapes the minds of people reading it. Do you make an effort inside to ask who leaked it? Why is this out?
Yes, yes. Our president has talked to the client.
And?
About finding out who leaked it. But I don't know if we have any results on that yet.
Okay. All right. So let's talk about the presidential survey. Perhaps you can share. Why do you believe is Senator Marcos retaining such a staggering lead?
Well, obviously, he has captured the imagination of a good percentage of our voters. Also, he has more than adequate resources to sustain his presence in social media, to sustain his caravans, to sustain his campaign. He has that edge. Mm-hmm. Plus, his name, of course, and the association with his father is definitely benefiting from that.
Mm. In comparison to other presidential races, have you seen something even slightly similar or comparable?
No, because this is the first time we're seeing a majority percentage selecting one candidate.
Mm-mm. Because let's remind the public, during President Duterte's time, what were his latest numbers in February or March?
In March, he was, I think, 24%, while Grace Poe was 27%. But come April, he was already, I think, 31% ahead of Grace Poe.
Yeah, the highest that Duterte has ever hit in Pulse Asia would have been 36.
I'll have to check that if you will allow me.
Sure.
I need to check it.
Because that would be interesting if at 36%, you already have President Duterte then garnering 60 million votes.
Sorry, it's 39.4%.
Almost close to 40. Yes. So when did Duterte achieve that?
April.
And by that time, his who was second to Duterte then?
Poe, at 21.8%.
So it was already a gap of roughly 20%.
Yes.
So if you compare it to the numbers today, what are you seeing in terms of your survey? How much? Yes.
We're seeing a much wider lead today. It's almost 40, it's 45 percentage points. So it's more than double the lead of Duterte over Poe in April 2016.
Mm-hmm. And at this point, even if Mr. Marcos drops by, he would have to drop, even if he drops 20 points, that would mean in the level of President Duterte, would it be harder for the others to still catch up?
Well, if he drops 20 points, that means the others will be getting some of those 20 points. And so they have a better chance compared to now.
But then compared to the last elections, it didn't matter, it seems.
Well, that's because the lead is still quite large, still 20.
Mm-mm.
But if majority of, let's say, Bongbong Marcos sheds 20 percentage points, if majority of that goes to, let's say, Lenny, that would reduce the gap between them to 5 percentage points.
But then that's close to impossible because they're like, I mean, on opposite poles, at least those two candidates. Is that correct?
It's rather difficult, especially since we're seeing the same numbers that we saw, essentially, the same numbers that we saw in January.
Mm-hmm. All right. Now, Professor, you do have some people saying, with these numbers of Mr. Marcos, he's the sure winner. The elections are over. Pulse Asia's numbers, your survey is actually reinforcing that conclusion in people's minds.
Well, that is not our intention. We are just coming out with the results. But the best strategy really for the other candidates is just to strive harder and not conclude that.
Mm-mm. And you really believe including the B will not make a difference or a dent in these numbers?
Because of their small proportion in the population, the A, B.
Uh-oh. But for example, in NCR, wouldn't you say in NCR that would make a big difference, the B?
No, because NCR is still, there's still a minority even in NCR.
Mm-mm. What about the Visayas?
What about the Visayas?
For example, the rallies you're seeing in the Visayas that are quite massive for the opposition, you don't believe that would fall under the B?
No, they will not be under the B. Some of them might be there, but the greater percentage will still be C, D.
All right. Now, let's talk about the vice presidential race. It's quite similar. The numbers, quite similar with the presidential race.
Well, we have 53% supporting Sara Duterte and 24% supporting Tito Soto for a gap of 29 percentage points. Mm-hmm.
So how would you describe that gap?
It's also a rather large gap.
What would the gap have to be for the other candidates to even have a fighting chance to win over Mr. Marcos, statistically speaking?
Statistically speaking, if they are only 5 percentage points away from him, they would be statistically tied with him. Yeah. And that would make it easier to overtake him.
Yeah. Or even a 10 to 15% gap, no?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. And at this point in the day, are you seeing a mathematical possibility of such a big decline on Mr. Marcos's numbers? Because 60% is quite astonishing.
Yes, it's not impossible, but the probability is not large. The probability of that happening is not large.
Okay, now the future Pulse Asia surveys, is there any change in strategy or method? For example, I know you did test, this is, you did survey 2,400, am I correct?
Yes.
Will you be doing a larger number in the future?
No, unfortunately, we will just be surveying 2,400 respondents again.
Mm-mm. I'm sure Pulse Asia has seen comments on social media actually criticizing the survey firm, right? Saying it's unbelievable and kumbaga hindi na pinaniniwalaan ang survey po ninyo. Anong reaction po ninyo sa ganito, ma'am?
Well, we are aware of that. We sort of expect that reaction. We will just to continue to produce the results because we stand by our data and our methodology.
And these surveys, of course, that you are releasing are not funded by any political group.
No, this is ours. It's non-commissioned. That's why we can share the results with media. If it were commissioned, we cannot share the results.
Now, I'm sure that within the group, there is some room for analysis on these numbers. Would this be proving Alito Banayo's point, his claims that with Lenny Robredo, there is a cap. Is that something that Pulse Asia sees?
Well, the data is certainly suggesting that.
That there is a cap?
Yes.
Okay, and explain that cap.
Well, it's just that that is her voter support.
Which is what, 15% to 20%?
I won't really hazard a guess on that.
Okay. Now, you have Manny Pacquiao, Senator Manny Pacquiao reacting, and he did say, baka naman daw hindi maghirap ang kausap ninyo. That's why he's trailing in the survey.
Well, we have Class E in the survey, and he does better in Class E than in Class C. Mm-mm. But we have covered the Class E.
Oo. And what is the story with Manila Mayor Isko Moreno? Is the trajectory, are you seeing it from the first time you surveyed? Has it gone up?
The increase in two percentage points over January is not significant. So essentially, he has stayed at the same level.
Go on. Uh-oh.
He has stayed at the same level. So yeah, we don't see an increasing trend.
Mm-mm. And where is Mr. Moreno getting the 2%?
Oh, I'm sorry. I didn't check on that.
Yeah, because what's quite interesting is Mr. Marcos's numbers seem to be solid. It's either I've seen a survey that's 54 or now 60. So it stays on that range.
Yes. Regarding Isko Moreno, where did he get the plus two? Well, although these are marginal increases, so he got it in balances on essentially.
Mm-mm. And would you be able to tell from whose votes?
No, that would be assuming. There could have been some transferring that we just cancel out, you know, between some of these candidates.
Uh-uh. Professor, in which socioeconomic class is Mr. Marcos strongest in?
He's getting his voters' support from all socioeconomic classes. He's getting his essentially the same voter support across socioeconomic classes.
Mm-mm. And where would you say is he strongest? Which region? We can discuss that.
Well, again, these are not that significantly different. He's getting in regions two and region one. Region one and region two are in the 80s. He's not getting it in region five, the Bicol region.
Yeah. But I wanted to ask you, is your survey reinforcing the solid north?
Well, it's seeing it, it's capturing it.
Yeah.
We are not reinforcing it, we are just capturing it.
Uh-oh. So it's capturing the solid north?
Yes, it is.
Mm-mm. Okay, and which candidate is even close to cutting into the solid north?
No one candidate, no candidate is coming close.
Mm-mm. So what's quite interesting, where is, for example, VP Lenny Robredo faring well?
Region 5, Bicol region, your region.
Uh-oh. And not even Luzon?
Not Luzon.
Not even. What about Manila Mayor Isko Moreno? One would think that after his performance in Manila, he would be faring or leading Luzon.
Well, no. It's not.
Yeah.
His best is 20% in Calabarzon and 22% in Mimaropa.
That's interesting. And would you be able to know why?
I think it's just that they have other preference. They prefer the other candidates to Isko Moreno.
Now, of course, Visayas and Mindanao, will the survey change once Cebu endorses?
I am not certain. I will have to see the data.
Mm-mm. Okay. Now, interesting, let's go back a bit to history. Has Pulse Asia ever been wrong?
No.
I mean, I've been covering the elections for a while. And let's talk about the 2004 elections. That's quite interesting. Did you predict that GMA would win?
Yes, we did.
You did? Uh-oh.
Yes, we did.
Mm-mm. Over Fernando Poe Jr.?
Yes.
And just, I know that it would take time. I don't expect you to open up, you know, the old numbers, but that was quite controversial for Pulse Asia. When did that happen? I mean, in terms of campaign months, when did that shift?
Well, I think we had her in the lead, even in February. Because I remember we did the survey because we were surprised by the lead.
Mm. Okay. So the exit polls, I remember this was a discussion in the past. Exit polls had it differently. That's when, you know, exit polls were still conducted, but it hasn't been done in the last, I think, at least in the last elections. So that was, you believe, one thing that Pulse Asia also predicted.
Well, the controversy in 2004 really was, we're not sure what the actual final count was because of the Hello Garci issue.
Okay. All right. So let's move back to the latest survey. I guess the next question is, the release of the next one will be in April, correct?
Yes.
And that would cover March.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
And do you feel there would be a change given in the rallies that are being brought together, put together by the opposition and other candidates?
Well, we will just monitor if there are any changes. I won't predict that there will be, but or there will not be. But we will just monitor the changes.
All right. Well, on that note, Professor Anna Tabunda, thanks for joining me today.
Thank you.
I do hope to speak with you and Ronnie Holmes again soon.
Thank you so much. Bye.
All right. Take care, ma'am.